depan nggak masalah. Kalau ada yang mau duduk di depan silahkan memenuhi kursi yang di depan. Atau masih ada beberapa kursi kosong juga di depan silahkan. Silakan mengisi kursi yang ada di depan maupun di tengah-tengah.
cek cek.
Kepada Bapak Ibu sekalian yang masih ada di depan, kami persilakan untuk segera masuk karena acara akan segera dimulai. Untuk teman-teman yang baru datang, di sebelah kiri saya masih ada beberapa kursi yang tersisa, silakan. Untuk yang baru datang, masih ada beberapa kursi di sebelah kiri saya yang bisa diisi, silakan. Selamat siang, assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh dan salam sejahtera bagi semua. Dan saya atas nama Pusat Kajian Perlindungan Anak Pustaka UI bersama UNICEF, Jaringan Peduli Anak Indonesia dan Semeru mengucapkan selamat datang di hari yang berbahagia ini, di siang hari ini pada kuliah umum Ibu Marta Santos Faris dan Special Representative of Director General of Violence Against Children. Kuliah umum ini bertema perlindungan anak untuk mengakhiri kekerasan terhadap anak, refleksi terhadap upaya yang berhasil dan rencana ke depan. Saya akan sedikit memberikan pengantar mengenai Ibu Marta yang telah menjabat sebagai Special Representative of the Secretary General on Violence Against Children sejak tahun 2009 dan sejak saat itu aktif mengadvokasi dan mendukung pencegahan dan pengurangan berbagai bentuk kekerasan terhadap anak yang mungkin terjadi di semua ranah di mana anak berada. Kuliah umum pada siang ini adalah bagian dari salah satu kegiatan rutin yang dilakukan oleh Pusat Kajian Perlindungan Anak, yaitu seminar Learning Series, merupakan suatu penghargaan karena hari ini Ibu Marta dan Profnya bisa ada di antara kita. Pak Ir, Profesor Irwanto adalah pendekar dari Puskapa yang juga telah banyak berkiprah dalam upaya perlindungan anak di Indonesia. Prof. Irwanto juga adalah Ketua Koalisi Nasional untuk melawan eksploitasi seksual terhadap anak dan Direktur dari Pusat Kajian Disabilitas dan Universitas Indonesia. Untuk segera memulai, saya akan langsung persilahkan Profesor Irwanto yang pada hari ini bersedia untuk menjadi moderator untuk kuliah hari ini.
Thank you, Agus, dan Ibu Asyik. Presidensi Madam Marta Santos Paris, now presence with us. This is really an honor and a privilege for me to be able to chair the session. I know that many of you may have the opportunities to meet very important people, but this is certainly one very important individual that has contributed so much on the understanding and also on mobilizing resources to fight against violence against children. So thank you for coming, Madam Marta Santos Paris. Thank you for all of you to come to this general lecture. I would like to thank the SMERU representative, World Vision, for UNICEF, SWAKA, Bapenas, Kemensos, many friends, activists, and also students. I'm very certain that all of you will enjoy the lecture and learn as much as Ms. Pais also learned from you later in Q&A. The floor is yours.
Good afternoon. Hello. I'm so thankful. Hello again. I'm so thankful and so honored to be here. Very important campus of the Indonesian University. And I'm so thrilled to see someone who has inspired the work of all of us here, but who is also continuing to have such a leading role. It's really an honor to be chaired by such an activist and a committed human being to the same cause that brings us here, which is to ensure that all children grow up with the best possible environment and we're living in the world with the greatest hopes and shaping the world to meet the expectation of these hopes. And so thank you so much for being here today and for allowing me to learn from the great work that is being done here in the university and about to go enriched by the important recommendations that I'm sure you will have to make afterwards and to share. I will bring them in my heart and also will be taking them very seriously for my work. I want to apologize that I don't speak the language that you would prefer to listen to. Bahasa Indonesia, which is so beautiful, but I'm not yet able to do that. I think I could be enrolled in one of your courses to have an intensive exposure and be able to speak better. But I'm really very happy to have the opportunity to share with you the work that we have been promoting with so many friends, with all of you, many friends who are representing here the United Nations. Of course, I'm thrilled to have here with us very dear friends from UNICEF in Indonesia, colleagues from civil society organizations, researchers and academics who are inspiring the minds of Indonesian policymakers to have a better nation for children. I'm really very happy to be here. But I wanted to tell you about this important work on violence against children. And many of the things I will speak about you have heard and you know very well, but it is just to reach a moment where I can learn from you when we will have a debate. As you know, we are this year celebrating in Indonesia 25 years since Indonesia ratified the Convention on the Rights of the Child. And this is an important year because it gives a perspective of a quarter of a century where so much has changed in the country, so many developments are to be acknowledged and celebrated, but also where I'm sure we feel always a bit impatient and frustrated because so much more could have been done and we want to go so much faster towards the future. Now, the convention is important certainly because it is the most widely and comprehensive treaty in the United Nations history addressing the rights of the child, but because especially it has become a reference for the work done by governments, by the academia, by activists, by child rights defenders, and also an inspiration for children and young people when they want to contribute to improve the world in which they live. But the convention is not a symbolic document simply. It establishes very concrete requirements for all governments to follow. So whenever a government adopts new legislation, new policies, new strategies, new programs, the convention needs to be in reference and it continues to be an indicator of how seriously governments take children in their work and in their efforts. The convention is fundamentally present in all countries of the world. This is, of course, very important. But for many children, it is a very distant reality, as in fact. They grow up not really understanding what it means to have rights, and when they are victims of physical maltreatment or sexual abuse or humiliation, they ask themselves, what does the convention mean for me on my daily life? And sometimes they do not believe it makes quite a difference. So we need to capitalize on what we can do. But the convention is important because it gives some indications of what we can all do. And the first thing it calls us to do is to say that every day, each decision I will take, as a student, as a professor, as a mother, or as a social worker, is to always find what is the best solution for the child, rather than serving my own interests as government or civil society or international organization. It requires us to always look to the children who may be left behind, those who do not have a voice, those who feel that they are left out. And it requires us to take decisions engaging with young people so that we don't assume we know everything, but we really listen to what young people propose, recommend, and aspire to. These principles are important because in a way they tell us that to prevent violence we need to always think about what is best for children rather than for any other purpose. But the convention is also very important because it is explicitly condemning any form of violence. As you know, the convention prohibits torture or inhuman or degrading treatment or punishment. This is perhaps a bit extreme. But it prohibits any form of trafficking, any form of sexual abuse or exploitation, any form of economic exploitation, including through domestic work, where sometimes young people are helping other families to support their own families. So it goes through a very long list of non-negotiable principles, where if they are to be respected, we will limit the risk of children becoming violence. But despite this very clear message, still today the reality for children is very different. We think that every year between 500 million to 1.5 billion children suffer some form of virus. That is a lot. It's big. It's really in today's world. When children suffer violence, they feel so frightened that most of the time they don't tell anybody about the trauma they fear, that they don't feel. And sometimes families feel it's better not to tell outside what has happened. Imagine a case of a sexual abuse by a member of the family. The family feels that to protect the victim, the child victim, and to allow for the family not to be affected by a wave of shame, it's better not to tell anybody. But the trauma of the child will not go away, the silence, as we know. And therefore, we are in fact silencing a very deep hurting feeling that will very often lead to very risky behavior later in life. We also know that for many families, when children don't behave, and as adults and as children, we don't behave very often, as we know. But parents feel that it's not a problem to teach a lesson to the child, you know, to pull the ears or to beat the child, maltreat the child. And we have very dramatic situations or very less dramatic but still very hurting situations of parents using hard discipline to teach children a lesson. And the same happens in schools, you know. Almost 80 countries in the world don't have even a prohibition of the use of corporal punishment. So to request the message that it is okay to punish children using some sort of violence. For many forms of violence, let me use one example. When a girl is forced to get married at a very early age, we also see the pressure of society and the perception that it's better to accept tradition rather than to challenge it. And therefore, when we try to look for data and research in most countries on different forms of violence, we find very little. I know that, for instance, in Indonesia, despite many important initiatives, there is no national study on the incidence and prevalence of violence on children. And this will be important, of course. It's not to feel bad about the results, it's also to have a sense of what is happening and how can we prevent and address this very dramatic reality. So, the contrast between what the Convention on the Rights of the Child says and very often constitutions and laws say and reality continues to be very, very wide. It is for this reason that in early 2000, the Committee on the Rights of the Child, which is this body in the United Nations that monitors the implementation of the Convention on the Rights of the Child, decided to have some discussions to see what do we know about this reality and how much do we miss and we should address in the future. There were two very important discussions with participation of many, many people. And as a result, it was felt that the truth is we don't know enough about violence against children. And it's probably very wise to ask the United Nations to have a study on violence against children that can get together all the information we may have from Asia, Latin America, Europe, about different forms of violence and pull it all together so that we understand what are the problems, the concerns, but also what are the good experiences that can give us ideas about how we can prevent and address this important phenomenon. The study was developed, and in 2006 it was presented to the United Nations, and many of you may have seen this study. It's a fat study, a good piece of research for all the academics and future academics here. It's a wonderful reference for all of us. As we know well, very often when we do a study, we keep it very nicely in a bookcase in our living room or in the beautiful library of the university. And once in a while we go back to it, oh, there were these great ideas, but we fail to bring it to the table of policymakers, no? And governments are trying to find new laws and policies on violence, but they don't remember that there was a study that in fact could guide their decisions, could inform reflections at the national level. So the United Nations felt that this study is so solid that we cannot afford to keep it in the bookcase. No? We need to bring it from the shelf into the discussions. And it was decided that to achieve that goal, the United Nations should establish one position in which I finance the position of representative of the Secretary General to keep the discussions going and reminding governments about the opportunity of changing the pattern of violence that shapes the violence, the life of children. So I started at the end of 2009, and for the last 5 years have been working in this manner. And as you may guess, it's very humbling because we need to deal with all children around the world, all countries around the world, all forms of violence, from physical to emotional, sexual, violence happening in the street, in the schools, in institutions, in detention centers, in the home. And we need to think about children who are babies and children who are adolescents. And it's huge, this agenda. So when we were thinking, what is the only way we can work? Certainly you have to agree with me, the only way was to bridge this goodwill of doing well, of course, with all the actors around the world who are equally committed. So I have been acting as a bridge builder, as someone who tries to learn from all of you in all countries, someone who creates platforms to discuss and who tries to get good information on things that work and reflections, discussions, research about things that do not work, or the root causes, why violence continues to be a problem in today's world. No? And this has helped me a lot, as you may guess. Now, I have very good news, you know, over the last 5 years, so much has changed. For instance, in Indonesia, a lot has changed over the last 5 years. I feel it's very important to recall the way that in the country you have promoted a review of the child protection law of 2002 last year, and where there was an opportunity to give a higher attention to sexual violence against children. That is an important contribution. I'm also very encouraged by the new law on juvenile justice adopted by Indonesia, which has, in fact, encouraged the need to prevent children from being criminalized and deprived of liberty, and encourages countries to explore opportunities of diversion and restorative justice. So rather than punish the child who did commit an offense, look at the child as the human being who has the right to a second chance, who can be supported in benefiting from that second. So we have good things in Indonesia and in many parts of the world to celebrate. For instance, to give you a few examples. Today, more than 90% of the countries around the world have one piece of legislation to protect children from sexual abuse. That is huge. It's very, very good. We have many countries with laws against trafficking in children or against child labor, where children are forced to be involved in exploitative and certain violent activities. So good news are happening. But we have other areas where there is less to celebrate. One example is certainly the fact that only 45 countries have one legislation that prohibits all forms of violence, including within the home, the family. And we know that the family is a very private place for all of us. It's also a very important protective environment for children. But despite the goodwill of parents to be the best parents possible, we also know that violence happens also within the family, and therefore the legislation is important to convey a message to society. We also have very good initiatives to raise awareness about in the public about the negative impact of violence on children. Sports on television, discussions on radio. I was this morning with a group of young people here in Indonesia who were telling me about their social media campaigns to prevent bullying and cyberbullying and to support victims. And you see, this is really mushrooming. Everybody wants to do something about these issues and everybody wants to join hands. I'm sure that here in the university, you will have many experiences that you can tell us about. one aspect that I think is very important is that in many countries we also have commissions for human rights or child rights that act as a spokesperson for the rights of children. That is also very promising to protect human rights. But there are other areas where we don't see the same important developments happening at the same pace. For instance, in many countries, we don't have data about violence against children. In many countries, there are social norms that in fact justify or condone the use of violence or some manifestations of violence. And it is very difficult to overcome the social taboos around those practices. And of course, we need to address them. So a lot is still to do. One aspect that to me has been very encouraging is that in all regions, we see also regional organizations joining hands to do better across the region. And you know that here in East Asia, ASEAN has been quite active in addressing violence against women and violence against children, and there is now a very strong declaration adopted by ASEAN in this area. And I think if we go back to that declaration, there are so many recommendations that we can translate into reality, and we should never forget the opportunity of doing so. In fact, I'm going to meet ASEAN, the ASEAN Commission on the Rights of Women and Children, this coming Friday. So that we can learn about, you know, what Indonesia is doing, but what Thailand and Philippines and Vietnam and Cambodia are also doing, and how can we benefit from good practices and also stimulate each other to go better. And you know, one secret I have really learned is that when we seek all these different countries together, there is this hidden sense of competition, and there is no country who wants to be behind. And everybody wants to have many good examples to share. And the first year, perhaps, there are a few who have good stories to tell, but the year after, many others want to tell even more. And this, in fact, acts as a catalyst for change. So we need to capitalize on it. You know, it's like children, you know, when they are in a game. I like soccer, let me use soccer as an example. And you have different teams, and all the teams want to win the tournament, you know? Everybody does the best, and at the end, everybody gains from that. So the regional cooperation is, of course, very important. But despite all of this, children suffer many and different and deep situations of violence against children. And in fact, you know, when I meet young people, they always go back to two terms that really touch me deeply in my heart. They describe their life in two words. One is fear of being bitten, fear of being stigmatized, fear of being exploited, fear of not being believed, not being supported, and pain. Pain that is very often suffered in silence, you know. We've no one to share the story, the frustration, the sense of shame and guilt, and how that in fact in turn aggravates the suffering of children. So we still have a long way to go. And this happens in all countries of the world. One example I always like to give. Now, my office is in New York, in the United States, and the United States did a very good survey to understand the impact of violence on children. And you know what? Despite very good services and very good campaigns and efforts, more than 60% of the children were suffering some form of violence. In fact, in the United States, every, I think it is 5 seconds, there is one child dying as a result of violence. It's huge. So we have these dramatic figures, you know, that really are hard to believe, and we need to take them very seriously and do something about it. And I know that in Indonesia, you also have some data that, of course, are an alarm bell for all of us, which may be high levels of physical aggression within schools or in boarding schools or in institutions, high level of emotional abuse. If we think about how Facebook can help post read messages about people we don't like in our school, or just spreading a bad rumor. We understand how widely this can get and how out of control this can get. And we know that in so many cases, children feel so desperate, but sometimes they even commit suicide. So we are dealing with a very dramatic problem. Now, we think about how the adolescents and we feel up, but they can speak up and they can find and very often find the targets to tell their stories. But think about the baby. A baby that is violently shaken by the mother because the baby doesn't stop crying. Or the baby who is left for hours and hours without anyone stimulating him or her, or expressing a sense of affection, or being placed in an institution where there are hundreds of other children and the staff cannot really cope with all those children to have that personal linkage with the child. And we have learned, as you know, that now even the development of the brain is affected when this situation of absence of affection or stress or tension is impacting on the life of very, very young babies, very, very young children. So we are talking about very, unsurmountable situations. You may have seen that 2 months ago or so, WHO published a global status report on violence prevention, and it recalled that 1 in 4 adults reported for that important study that they had suffered physical abuse when they were children. 20% of women and between 5 and 10% of men told that they had been sexually abused when they were children. And very often they have not told their stories. So it stays with oneself for a long, long period of time, sometimes forever. And this helps to make violence a factor that generates violence as we grow up. In fact, people who have been suffering abuse will be using violence against their partners, against their own children, because that's what they have been confronted with when they were young. And therefore, we don't really get out of this vicious cycle. No? And we know that children who suffer abuse very often may be tempted to engage in risky behavior. It may be alcohol abuse, it may be drug abuse, it may be criminal activities, or it may be that they feel so defenseless that they are easy targets for criminal networks who take advantage of these children. So a lot is in fact happening around one incident of violence. For this reason, I have been very eager to capture the views of children, understanding the vision that young people have of the present, but also of the future without violence. And recently, joining hands with many civil society partners, we decided to look into what young people around the world, below the age of 18, are dreaming for the world beyond 2015. And we looked into the views of more than 800,000 children and adolescents who have participated in more than 80 national consultations and who have participated in online surveys about what would they like to see the world look like between 2015 and 2030, which is the time where we will have a new global development agenda that the United Nations is finalizing at present. And interestingly, one key message from these children was that education is fundamental to prevent violence, although education settings are unfortunately a place where violence often takes place, maybe bullying. It may be physical aggression, emotional aggression, corporal punishment, and sexual abuse, so many forms. And the second message from the children was systematic in all regions that violence is the most pressing concern that governments need to address most urgently because it is affecting everyday life. Now, this tells us a lot. It may be violence expressed through early and forced marriage, it may be physical violence, sexual violence, but children are worried about this and they expect us all adults to make a difference in this regard. So we have great expectations that governments all around the world will create an agenda for development that will preserve the recognition of this person at its heart and will ensure that people have indicators to monitor progress over time in this global development agenda. Now, I am always very touched by the fact that children feel and suffer with violence, but at the same time, the sense of resilience that children convey is endless, is limitless. And I am very, very inspired by the number of initiatives young people promote around the world. It may be through social media networks, through the creation of blogs and websites, but it may also be coming to the communities and organizing street dramas, or having radio programs to explain what it feels to be victim of a situation of violence and what are the solutions that can work best in the community or at the national level. And we need to really capitalize on these great solutions that children can provide for facing this problem. The other aspect I'm very inspired by is that young children express a great sense of solidarity. And I'm sure you will have great examples. We know that, for instance, for a victim of bullying, the most dramatic challenge is understanding that there are many bystanders that remain passive and do not try to understand how hurt you feel when you have been victim of bullying. And at the same time, how important it is when friends come and ask, but what happened? You seem so silent, you seem so isolated, you seem so upset. What can we do to support it? There is nothing that becomes emotional. It's not a magic challenge. Tell me what is happening in that. And very often we see in schools the rates being generated and opportunities to overcome these dramatic challenges being addressed by everybody in school or university. One aspect we have learned, and of course you know this better than I can tell, is that violence hurts when it happens. We slap a child and of course it hurts. Or we humiliate a child and it hurts. But the dramatic thing it is that it lasts for a long period of time. It doesn't go away by magic. And that is of course a big risk. We know that the children who suffer violence may be much more at risk of becoming addicted to alcohol or addicted to drugs or other important substances. That can be so dramatic for the adults. And we also know that very often children who are victims of situations of violence may be later in life involved in criminal activities and may be drawn into criminal activities, including organized crime, drug trafficking, arms trafficking, and so on. That is, of course, having an impact not only on the child and the family, but on society. And this is an argument that I think is resonating with governments. When you talk about money, governments listen perhaps more than when you talk about how children suffer. And I am very struck by how important the impact is, the costs are, directly and indirectly, when violence takes place. And I wanted to tell you about a recent study that was published last year that stressed that the global cost of violence against children, including homicide, child abuse, and sexual abuse, was $3.7 trillion US dollars, or 4.3% of the global GDP. This is really huge. And when we tell governments, you know, you are spending all this amount of money, and if you would invest in prevention, you could save so much and really invest in making sure that all children have access to basic social services of health, education, and social protection, so that violence doesn't take place, and if it takes place, they can be supported, and you still could have money to do many other things. Then governments start thinking, oh, perhaps I'm really missing what is important in this discussion. And we have an opportunity to shift the policies and the budgetary decisions that are being taken around the world. I hope you will help me with this. Now, nonetheless, you know, when we think about the data we know, it's quite telling, apart from the economic data I just mentioned. Close to 1 billion children every year suffer some form of physical abuse. This is so big, isn't it? I mean, we are 7 billion people around the world. Imagine that 1 billion children suffer some form of physical abuse. This may be just yelling and shouting, but it may also be being beaten by a belt or a stick or some kind of other object, you know? When we look at the data that we have, including the data published by UNICEF and many other actors, one thing that strikes us is that parents, the family, use sometimes violent discipline, but when they are asked, do you think this is necessary? Close to 90% say, we don't think it's necessary, but what can we do? I mean, this is the only way we know how to teach children a lesson, discipline children, and make them responsible citizens. And this means that we have a great opportunity to create great programs and initiatives to promote good parenting and to promote positive discipline alternatives. And sometimes we have these very easy messages that really touch the heart and the mind of people that make that twist that we need to include everywhere around the world. Another aspect that, of course, we cannot ignore is how new technologies are having an impact in this agenda. I know that most young people here in Indonesia have mobile phones or smartphones or computers or laptops or iPads or social media connection. It's fantastic. I understand that probably in Southeast Asia, Indonesia is the country where young people are using the most new technology. This is great because we can learn, we can do research, we can listen to music and videos, we can connect with our friends, and in fact, we can very quickly Google about my website. So there is a lot we can learn, including I'm feeling so depressed because I was bullied, and I can look at what is being done and where can I seek advice about what can help me overcome this problem. But the truth is that with new technologies, we also know there are many risks that are associated. And what is dramatic is that many young people are not fully aware of the risks. And in many circumstances, parents do not know how to support their children in preventing those risks or in surfing the cyberspace as we help children cross the street or drive a bicycle. You know, we go with our child so that the child doesn't fall. But in this particular universe, I think children and young people learn much faster and parents feel a bit behind. That's certainly my case. And this generational divide makes things even more difficult for parents who feel that they can help their children. So we have now a new challenge. And if we think about how a rumor can be spread across the world amongst millions of people in a fraction of a second, and it will stay there forever. We understand the risks, but they do not have to be affected. We can prevent them, and therefore there is a lot we can do to empower children, support parents, and invest in schools who can really be a source of inspiration and support to children and their families to prevent these risks. Now, I'm coming to an end because I'm talking too much, but I want to tell two things there. One is that we have done a study looking at reports from 105 countries around the world to understand what they were doing to protect children from violence, what were the major concerns, where they see the opportunities for change. And we learned many things from the analysis of these reports from these more than 100 governments. Of course, we learn good things that are happening. There is a greater awareness about violence against children. People discuss it more. It's not so much a taboo in parliament, in government, in the village, in this in the schools. But we also saw that in most countries, policies to address violence against children remain very piecemeal, fragmented, dispersed. And if there is a bad case happening in a country, particularly when it captures the imagination of the media and we see it on the cover page of a newspaper, the reaction is to find a quick fix for that problem rather than understanding what was the reason behind and how can I prevent it better, right? And very often governments say, oh, I'm going to criminalize, I'm going to put people in jail, I'm going to be tough, I'm going to be repressive. But we forget that before repression can make a difference, there is much more that could be done to prevent things from occurring in the first place. So fragmentation of policies is a big risk. The other one is there are many pieces of legislation, but very often we don't have a clear message across all legislatures to say this is not acceptable. And that is important, you know. I know that in Indonesia, as I said, there are good new pieces of legislation, but it could be very good to have one clear message in the law which could say no violence against children is acceptable because we can prevent it, we can address it. We still have a way to go. We have also felt that governments don't invest in prevention and don't invest in particular in services for families and for children, you know, close to where they live, you know, with quality, so that we don't have to deal with the bad impact of all that we can prevent from before happening. And then finally, we don't have enough research and enough data about violence against children. But still, we have good, examples. I have to say I'm very excited by the new strategic plan adopted by Indonesia, which provides a vision for the future in the country and gives very visible attention to violence against children. Therefore, I am very hopeful that you will help inspire within that important framework of the Strategic Plan of Indonesia a clear strategy and an implementation plan on how to prevent and address violence against children. Of course, with the needed resources for implementation, otherwise, we don't go far without the resources. And that needs to happen at the local level where children are. Otherwise, we will also fail in our efforts. And we need more data, because I am in a wonderfully and very well-known and respected academic center. I think you can help so much. Bring together the data sources that exist in Indonesia about violence against children. We have data in hospitals. We have data in police stations. We have data in courts. We have data in schools. But very often, the definitions don't match each other. Some institutions have bits of information, but the information is not integrated, is not centrally overseen, and the public does not know what the data is telling. And so we fail to use the advocacy messages that would be so instrumental to change policies and to change action in the country. It would be fantastic if that would be feasible in the near future in Indonesia. And you know what we could achieve would be to bring the statisticians and the academics together with the policy decision makers, because that is where we will make a real difference in the future. But I'm saying this, and this is my final point, because now the world is on the verge of adopting a new global development agenda, a sustainable development agenda for the world between 2050 and 2030, as I mentioned earlier. And what is interesting is that what is in the draft of that global agenda and in the medium strategic plan of Indonesia is very similar on violence against children. And I have the feeling that the voice of Indonesia can influence the global agenda adopted by the international community next September. But at the same time, when we reach January 2016, Indonesia can be ready for an implementation process of your strategic plan that can show other nations in Asia and other nations around the world how you can go faster in making the reality for all children, that they can grow up without the risk of violence, that they can grow up without being frightened, without being insecure, and without being hurt and wounded deeply in their hearts and in their minds. And if we achieve that, I think Indonesia can be it's like a vaccine, you know, injecting this shield against violence and making every child feeling smiling and hopeful around the world. And what a wonderful thing this could be for Indonesia to achieve. And when I look around this wonderful room, I think you can all help us with that. And I really want to continue to be in touch with you so that your ideas, your suggestions, your reflections, your studies can help me bring them to others and infect others positively to have a vaccine against the COVID-19. So thank you again for having me here and in anticipation of what you are going to tell me. Thank you for what I learned.
Thank you. Very inspiring. A lot of data, a lot of issues that has been spread out. And I think now it's our turn, or your turn, and also maybe next, also my advisor's turn to ask you questions. So we have plenty of time. I would like to suggest also the temperature of the room. I mean, to ask you to consult with you. Is it warm, yeah. I find it warm. Well, if you can help us lower the temperature a little bit, that might be helpful to us. Okay. As the time flies, it's best for us to use the time right now. And you can ask questions or comments in Bahasa and Bahasa English because direct translation is available. So please raise your hand. I will choose around 3 or 5. Any comments? Any? Yes, please. Maju ke depan. Sebutkan nama sama isi pada diri. Siap diri. Sebutkan nama dan asalnya.
I'm Hannah from Social Work Department. My question is different with other country. In Indonesia, all about sexual things is a taboo. So, while sexual abuse and harassment often happen to the children in here, so what can we do to fight this internal barrier to educate society to be more open-minded about it? Thank you.
Jadi tabu ini ada di keluarga maupun di komunitas ya?
Okay. Di sekolah.
So tabu about sexual violence everywhere. And the culture of the child, okay. Yang lain? Thank you dulu, Pak.
Halo, good afternoon, Ms. Fine. My name is Serena, I'm a psychologist. Lately, I'm handling mostly about the case of violence in children. And most often also the one who did the violence to them are their own parents or someone close to them. And behind the violence, you know, so I found out that there are a little knowledge from the parents about the milestones of their children. So they don't have a full understanding about if my son or my daughter is 2 years old, they will do many trouble things. They call it trouble too, right? So they have a last question on it and they do violence for children. And I learned that so many parents also having the same experience, that they have no idea about what's happening in their household and the development of their children, and then they lost passion and then they do the violence. I'm listening to what you said about how to prevent and about how to give some kind of parenting program for the parents. But here in Indonesia, we have so many kinds of styles of parenting, many kinds of values, religions, tribes, cultures, and it's so difficult to pick one general how to, to make the parents from all the various types to understand how to handle their children. What I'd like to hear from you is just your opinion about this. This coming out of my mind about these cases, about is it necessary that we have some kind of screening test for people before they have children? Are they proper to have children or not? It's just my hopeless dream about these kinds of things. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Well, you're okay.
My name is Mio.
Yes. Okay. I just want to ask about the concluding observation by the UNCRC committee until now. I think this year, they're sending back to the Indonesia country how they're monitoring about the implementation of the UNCRC in Indonesia. Because I think Indonesia is already too many times delayed to report to the UNCRC. But no specific response could be by the UN committee. How does the UNCRC committee monitoring and support to Indonesia government? And the second, about the, I think last year, Indonesia and under the UNICEF, they mentioned a national child protection system, but until now, I didn't see their good implementation could be Indonesia until now, and still happened many of the violent form of abuse happened in Indonesia and booming for the last year about the sexual abuse. Okay, thank you.
And you think there's a correlation between no protection system and booming?
Yes.
Okay, last one, please.
My name is Diane from World Vision Indonesia. We believe that in improving resilience of children in facing violence against children is to give them education and life skill for them. Do you have any some research or data to show this the real connection between resilience and life skill for the children? So we
to support our work when we give children life skill and education is give them resilience to face their parents, and our issue we have that they're facing. Thank you very much, and also thank you for speaking in English. Very important questions and very difficult questions, very difficult to have convincing answers, certainly. Sexual abuse, to go back to the first question, sexual abuse sexuality in general is considered a taboo in most countries. And it's really very difficult to bring it into the open. I think you're very right in saying that. And it becomes so difficult that those who are victims of sexual abuse find it even more difficult to tell what has happened because they feel that they are going to be blamed, judged, criticized. They certainly deserve a punishment, That's the sense. And there will be anything that can be done about it. And there are dramatic situations. I'm going to mention two from other parts of the world. There is one country in Latin America where the first cause of maternal mortality is suicide amongst adolescents who become pregnant. This is very sad. It's so sad. And yet, in that same country, when the government was willing to introduce some sort of culturally sensitive and age-sensitive sexual education, there was such a bad reaction, and it was so difficult to pursue it, that the only way after a long attempt by the government, in fact, in that case, the government was very much willing to promote a thoughtful program. The only thing that could be done and agreed upon was that rather than having a program on sexual education, again, sensitive and thoughtful for the age of the student. It had to be done by training the teachers, so that the only measure that was possible was to include a curriculum, either curriculum, some training for teachers to be sensitized for, in the future, to become ready to teach, to address the topic. So the resistance is very big. Now, we don't want to certainly create a revolution and make everybody unhappy and divide society, but we need to introduce small steps that can help bring this discussion into a more acceptable discussion. And very often we can start with small spots on television that can be quite harmless, you know. I remember that in some countries there was a little cartoon, and the cartoon was shown at very important moments on television. And the cartoon was showing a little child, green, so that you could not say if it was you know, in Africa or Asia or Europe, you could not say if it was a boy or a girl. And the little cartoon was very happy when there was a hand helping the little cartoon, and it would laugh, and it would giggle, and it would jump of joy. But when the hand was trying to go beneath the belly, the face of this cartoon would change dramatically and would say, ah. So it had no words, it needed no translation. And it was intended to sensitize parents to be assuming the responsibility of talking about these issues in the way they feel is right, but not to avoid a discussion because it can be so much more dramatic for everyone. So I'm giving this example because there will be, I'm sure, many ways of putting it. Sometimes we write articles on newspapers not to identify victims, but to tell the dramatic stories of those who suffer sexual abuse, and to tell about the impact in the family and the impact for society that people avoid addressing. Sometimes it is radio discussions. We bring pediatricians and we bring psychologists and teachers who constructively bring the topic into the open. Sometimes we have also the voice of young people who make everybody understand that they don't want to become irresponsible, but they just want the issue, the problem, not to be affecting and shaping their lives. So different approaches may achieve. It will take some time, I have the impression, in all societies, but we cannot afford to address it. And we were talking before coming into the room that next year we will celebrate 20 years of the first World Congress Against Sexual Exploitation of Children. And it was probably the first time that the topic was so open, you know, in all discussions, and the media made a big coverage of it. But in these 20 years, a lot has changed, but a lot has not yet changed. And we are losing generations of young people who go through dramatic situations, and we pretend not to be ready to support them. That cannot be postponed further. Now, the second topic, which is so, so important, how do we empower parents to be the best parents and be able to guide their children, advise their children, and help them grow and develop to their full potential without using any violence as a form of discipline or education, and without forgetting that the being a child is also testing things. It's also, you know, pretending we don't listen to the mother or the father say come to table because we need to have dinner, or it's time to go to bed, or, you know, just playing because we don't even realize there is someone telling anything. That's part of childhood. And being curious is part of childhood, and being sometimes defiant is also part of childhood. But that is not necessarily bad. I mean, the children do not intend bad things for being naughty, in a way. We were all naughty as we grew up. And when we do not, I mean, when we behave all the time, there is certainly something wrong. I didn't do that in a way. And what we have seen is that when parents are taught to, in fact, when we start even in school, young people are not yet thinking about becoming parents, but learning how to share responsibilities between boys and girls, learning about how to confront adversarial situations without being aggressive and violent, finding solutions that are peaceful, that are respectful, even if they imply that we do not agree necessarily with each other. But we can disagree while being respectful. There are so many things that can help us be better parents when things don't go the way we believe, and can help us overcome frustration, because sometimes we come home as parents very tired and exhausted and upset with our lives, and the child is the easy victim of all the frustration we bring from outside, you know. And therefore, we have seen that in many countries, again, cartoons have helped a lot, you know. And you see that the child is shouting, and the mother is shouting, and the father is shouting even louder, and then everybody gets very upset and sad. And next time we see the cartoon with people almost shouting, and then thinking, perhaps not. And I count until 10 and until 20, and I go to my room, and within 5 minutes we can talk about the problem without having been out of control. Or we can see chains of understanding. You know, I remember one cartoon that it was to me very powerful. It was young people who were hurting each other with a big slap on the face, and each one was stronger and more aggressive, and everybody was very upset and sad. But then one decided to break the cycle and decided to give a big hug to the neighbor. And the hugs became more and more increasing, and so happy, and everybody was happy. So there are so many different ways we can convey the message that we need to sustain the investment, do it all the time, and test ourselves. And being, I'm a mother and a grandmother. Being a mother is very difficult. Oh, and we need to be very patient, very patient. It's a big test. But once we do the right thing, we feel so proud of us. And that is a better sense than feeling frustrated because we didn't control our temper and really, you know, went beyond the limit that we had established for ourselves. So there are many different ways. Now, should we screen parents? I love the idea because I think it's challenging. And, you know, like anything. We are never perfect, but like we need to improve. We can improve, and we can always become better mothers and better fathers and better aunties and uncles and grandparents. And therefore, I wouldn't scream because there is no bad soul in the world. There is always room for change. But just you know, the same way we get a driving license to drive a car, it would be very good to have some moments where before jumping becoming a mother or a father, we can reflect on how serious the commitment is and for how long it's for life, and what it will entail for me. What am I going to give up or gain for becoming a mother or a father? Something you have learned, perhaps, that you will tell me what you have learned so that we can replicate. Then we had a very difficult question about the Committee on the Rights of the Child and what Indonesia can do and something. I was reading the recommendations of the committee to Indonesia last year. Of course, it's a long list and very important things that need to be addressed. You know, one, I was a member of the committee in Azerbaijan for many years, and one thing that to me was very important was that on the one hand, you feel I'm almost a judge at the global level of what happens in the country. And yet this country deals with thousands and millions of children. I'm very far away. And how can we really grasp the reality in that country and give the advice that is necessary that is going to make a difference? It's so humbling, my Lord. I'm like, I make a very bad judgment. So there is a big responsibility in the recommendations from the committee, but there is a great willingness to be as well informed as possible to give the right recommendation. That is true. But the real difference is not made by the committee. I think the real difference is made by the monitors at the national level. And this may be the civil society at the national level, the civil society at the community level, at the district level, the group, the grassroot organizations who push for change, who remind mayors that they didn't really, they completely forgot how the children when they planned the city and how to cross the street in the city. Or they didn't invest enough resources for children and families. And that is what will make the difference. So we need to build an alliance between the committee and the national monitors. And you will play a very important role in reminding governments, but also giving anticipating solutions, you know, that can work better. And perhaps the committee will be even better next time, you know, in doing the right thing. So it's a process of change, and it's never finished. That's the nice thing. I mean, we will always be needed, so we have a job forever. You know? That is quite good. Now, the national child protection system. We all believe that we need a system at the national level that places children at the center of the concerns. No? I don't think we can disagree with this. And why do we say this? Because there is no policy or decision that is neutral to children. We may be thinking, imagine, we think about a policy on housing. It's not necessarily about children, but the family is going to be in that house or lack of house, and the child is going to be inside. And if we do not think about what kind of house we need for children to be happy, or a playground outside, or a beautiful green space as you have in this campus, you know, the child is not going to be enjoying and developing in the same way. So everything has an impact on children. And the National Child Protection System, in fact, is a reminder that we need strong laws with children at the center. We need strong policies. We need budgets that are investing in children's policies and their services. We need to monitor how well we are doing. We need to look into the deep-rooted beliefs and social conventions that may compromise the protection of children. Sometimes with the best of intention, that can be harmful for children. And it is that combination of efforts where the Department of Education and Health and Social Protection and Justice and Foreign Affairs all join hands because children are important. That will make a difference for children. I know that UNICEF is working very actively here in Indonesia to be supportive of the efforts to create a national child protection system, as many of you are. I mean, all of you are playing a role. And it will take still much effort to achieve what we think is the best, but never give up because we don't go quickly enough. We need to keep being patient and keep steadily pressing for change. And we will celebrate it perhaps next year, you know, but we will celebrate it. And I will come back to celebrate with you. That's what I promise to do. The final point, I'm sorry, I'm a bit long, but these are great. The final question is even more difficult. I believe in education, you know. First of all, as I told you before, all children recognize education as being the most important investment for their lives. And I think that tells them a lot about its value. And all parents want their children to be in the education system, isn't it? I remember, I'm sorry, I'm going to tell you a little longer, but many, many years ago, I was visiting a refugee camp in Africa. And some of the children were from very distant countries, and they had been forced to travel through different countries to get to this refugee camp. And I was visiting the refugee camp, and my daughters had a big discussion in their school about school uniform. And their view, my daughter's view, was school uniform is not necessary. This is very bad, it doesn't make any difference, and we all look alike, and we cannot use our skirts and our shirts or whatever. And I still had that conversation in my mind. And when I reached this refugee camp, we went to the little school space, you know, very, very incipient, little quarter of the camp, and all children had one uniform, you know. They all dressed alike. And the truth is that I could not see who was Sudanese or from Uganda or from Kenya or from Ethiopia or Eritrea. They all looked alike. And I asked, you know, what is the value for you of being in this school? Because the school was so simple, you know. And they looked at me and they told me so many beautiful things. The first one was that when they were walking to school with their uniform, all the adults in the refugee camp had in their eyes a twinkling of hope, because they were looking at these kids as peacemakers and decision makers in the future with the skills necessary to change the world. Their world, small, big refugee camp, the world outside. But secondly, that uniform was the sense of belonging that they had. Having come from very distant places, you know, many of them having no family member alive. And if you look at this, it's like, God, the lesson that you're getting from these children is unique. And the belief that education can be the bridge to a different future was so important. So, you know, I always keep this in my mind, and when I listen to children, even when they are very frustrated because the teachers are absent and because what they learn in school is not always relevant for the lives they feel, there is much more that they take home that is so important. So I think the question is, how can we adults who shape the education system invest in making it as relevant, as inclusive, as sensitive as we can, for children to go happily home? School and come back home feeling empowered and skillful to prevent violence, to address problems, and to help their parents be even better parents, you know, be better citizens. But there is an opportunity that I think we cannot miss, and being in this university, of course, I know that you will see that great opportunity. I hope I have addressed the difficult question, but I'm looking forward to learning more.
Okay, then I'll ask you. About the life skill, do you need to go, you want to go further?
Yes. When I was in the committee, you know, we had a friend who used to say, remind us that education is not about the supermarket of knowledge, you know, that you go to the school and you have, I pick a few pears and apples and mangoes, and then I go home, I put them all together, and I am a very knowledgeable person. It doesn't happen like that. It is, how do you gain the skills that will help solve problems in your daily life? You know? And it may be the mangoes and the pears and the apples, or it may be something very different, rather than you know, being a recipient of ideas that are transmitted in a very strict manner by the great teachers we have, it is probably more important, or at least as important, to have an opportunity to discuss ideas. How do I see the problem? Where do I see the difficulty? What would I suggest as a solution? Even if I am different in my perception from everybody else, how can my opinion be supportive of the decision that will be a collective decision and we stand by it all together? So those skills are the richness that we want to have. And they will not happen if we do not have a friendly environment, a safe environment in school, if we do not have space for discussions, and we just have the supermarket of knowledge. So, this is a very easy way of addressing a difficult question, I was posed. In a way,
it's
trying to synthesize some of the things that
people
have better
than. Thank you. Menurut saya memang, let me speak about it. Ada dua hal yang mungkin perlu di highlight ya. Yang pertama itu mengenai life skill. Life skill has been interpreted in different ways by different generation of policy makers. Ya, aku sudah bilang bahwa bahasa Indonesia itu bahasa Inggris sih. Bahasa Indonesia aja karena sudah ada bahasa Inggris sih. Di tahun awal saya bekerja sama dengan UNICEF, saya dilatih oleh WHO, WHO di Geneva, khusus mengenai life skill, yang terutama berfokus pada confidence, self-confidence, self-esteem, kemudian apa, effective communication, problem solving, and all that. Tetapi ketika modul-modul kami selesai, 2 tahun kami menjalankan itu sampai ke Papua sebetulnya, tiba-tiba muncul jenderal baru di apa di Depdikbud yang change everything, yang tadinya apa life skill adalah soft skill menjadi hard skill, yaitu bagaimana berdagang, bagaimana apa namanya membuat sesuatu yang tentu lebih immediate results dan bukan ke long term investment and results. Sampai hari ini apa namanya kalau Anda melihat modul life skill itu sangat banyak aspek hard skill-nya. Sedangkan yang dibutuhkan tadi ya mengenai differences, conflict resolution, self-esteem, effective communication, and all those things itu satu. Yang kedua mengenai child protection. Child protection itu evolving idea, ya. Ini adalah ide evolving through evidence yang kita coba kumpulkan, especially on risk and vulnerabilities of children in different subsystems or the system overall. Yeah. Di waktu yang lalu kita selalu terjebak pada perdebatan mengenai anak yang dilahirkan, anak yang berkonflik dengan hukum, anak yang hidup di jalanan, tematik. Ya. Dan kita invest a lot of money even to deal with children living and working on the street, and result is very minimal. So rather than looking at tematic issues like that, UNICEF and partners juga save the children, di sana ada plan juga, ada lurah-lurahnya di situ. Itu looking at the risk and vulnerabilities di dalam subsystem di mana anak hidup, di dalam keluarga, di masyarakat, di pasar, ya. Itu dan kalau kita understand itu mungkin nantinya kita akan mendapatkan satu saya harap tidak terlalu lama mendapatkan satu unified theory support of risk and vulnerabilities. Tapi di samping itu yang menarik saat ini adalah upaya-upaya developing partners termasuk Indonesia untuk melakukan pelatihan-pelatihan bersama lintas sektor. Tadinya sektor sendiri, kepolisian berarti sendiri, jaksa berarti sendiri, hakim sendiri, NGO sendiri lagi, ya, apa, jenis-jenisnya sendiri. Ini tidak menggunakan apapun. Karena masing-masing kemudian, kalau saya tahu sendiri, semua. Padahal mereka harus bekerja dengan orang lain. Oleh karena itu sekarang ini sudah pusing, Bapenas sendiri sudah mengupayakan latihan-latihan terpadu lintas sektor. Ya. Sehingga begitu mereka keluar latihan itu, they know how to speak to each other, they know how to plan things. Saya kira itu apa namanya kualifikasi dua hal. Tadi menjadi top jemputin. Ada pertanyaan berikutnya, silakan Mas. 2, 3, 4, 5 banyak sekali. Mari.
Thank you, Mr. Bata. Just my sister, my sister Wanda is mentioning what we did. I'm Abdullah from Glen International Indonesia, responsible for advice on child protection. What we did in a building system, there is three big components. There is tradition, welfare, and legal framework. Now we follow what has been advised by Mr. Dewan, how to work in some system on the thematic issues. What we did now, we work in more than 280 villages. We work with all families, with all parents, with all religious leaders. Even though only around 60 or 70% we take it with, but it is very effective. In the past, for example, in our working areas, nobody can disclose about sexual abuse. But today, the family can bring this case to the court. Just an example. And it's a big challenge for us, how the system within the government to respond to that. But the government did not respond yet well when the community bring this. And we don't have enough capacity in referral mechanism when the community themselves and family themselves disclose or bring the case to the court because they could not stand on cultural only. They can go with the car beyond the legal process for the culture, but they still bring the criminal case, the criminal thing to the court. But what happened in our working areas, now we need to work together, the police, prosecutor, and medical treatment, anything. But what happened? Unfortunately, the district government did not allocate budget for that. That's a big problem in this country. Even though we have lots of things at national level, but look at the district level, or look at the village level. No, even no budget allocated for that. But the community now asking the government how to allocate budget at the village level, because village is a source of the problem. You can imagine, in our working area, there are 70 kilometers to bring the victim of sexual abuse to the center. What happened? And children is being passed away on the way to the hospital, something like that. So how now we can empower the village under the village authority, village autonomy, to be empowered to allocate the budget, to allocate to what we call to set up a regulation at the village level to prevent, because violence is preventable. Violence, according to our experiences, violence is preventable. Like this is preventable. But what happened today, when you are discussing about culture has changed. It's changing. For example, in East Nusa Tenggara, in the past, children could not say anything. Today, when there is a group of people in the village who are concerned with the protection, children, now they have the place to report. They have the place to disclose. But what we need to do is how to scale up this throughout the country, because we don't have enough what we call capacity and number of professionals. When we discuss about social worker, we don't have enough capacity for the social worker in NISA, even the number, because I am the social worker. We don't have enough number how to deal with this. It is just an example. Okay, this big progress in Indonesia, not only just living in Indonesia, very big progress in Indonesia, but it was not reported because underreported. Yes, we need to encourage the people here in this room, not just talking, just blaming, doing that in your own neighborhoods, just something to disclose, give the chance to the children to participate. Thank you.
Thank you. Very good, yeah? Ya, ada bapaknya dulu, Fatih, bapak-bapak dari sini, Pak, silakan.
Terima kasih, pimpinan. Berasa Prof. Sabirman. Prof, saya dengan Ibu Marta juga, saya ingin berbagi pemikiran. Pertama, gini, saya dari Jawa Barat, Pak. Saya pekerja sosial, tapi berhubungan dengan orang yang berhubungan. Tapi saya tertarik. Di Jawa Barat, itu berlomba-lomba SM untuk buat apa yang namanya kota ramah anak, ya kota ayah anak gitu ya. Menurut saya berlomba-lomba seperti itu, tapi kenyataan di lapangan ini persoalannya masih ada, violence masih ada, yang teman tadi bilang itu benar. Nah, jadi sebetulnya saya lihat kota yang layak anak tersebut sebetulnya bungkus doang, Pak. Tapi kenyataannya tetap. Jadi saya juga jadi tidak yakin.
Ini mas, bapak, sebelum dilakukan, karena ini tidak ada kemungkinan platformnya berbeda. Kalau mereka mengatakan justru karena masalahnya ada, maka cita-cita untuk menjadikan kota yang mulai kanan, itu yang dikejar. Justru karena masalahnya ada, kalau masalahnya tidak ada, ngapain? Ngapain?
Ya betul. Saya hanya ingin bertanya dengan Ibu Makta. Apakah di level internasional juga ada pendekatan-pendekatan sopan tentang kota ramah?
Ya.
Dan jangan di negara kita ini cuma gatal doang. Tapi sebenarnya implementasi itu pertama mas. Ya, okay. Terus yang kedua sebetulnya bertanya yang agak prihatin tadi tentang anggaran. Saya nggak melihat negara saya di sini kok anggaran berlebih. Cuma persoalannya bagaimana kita melakukan sebetulnya pada proses musrenbang mekanisme pembiayaan itu. Siapa yang mengawal proses ini yang children finance di tingkat musrenbang di bawah sampai di tingkat bapak untuk penganggaran. Saya juga butuh pengalaman dari negara-negara lain. Bagaimana mereka mengurus penganggaran tersebut supaya kekerasan pada anak. Yang terakhir tentang data source mas. Setiap tahun saya tidak pernah lihat semacam outlook children violence outlook setiap tahun yearly. Karena memang persoalan data source ini paling sulit karena masing-masing lembaga.
Kita nggak punya.
Ya Pak. Pak Prof. Bahkan saya ingin bertanya dengan Bu Marta. Bagaimana sebetulnya strategi yang paling pas dari seluruh komponen baik itu NGO, civil society, media, instansi pemerintah, penegak hukum itu ngomong tentang database open source sehingga bisa kritik, bisa solusi apa yang riset, apa yang kita dapat dari riset knowledge management ini juga benar. Mohon komentar. Terima kasih.
Terima kasih. Itu masih bagus sekali kepada untuk mas kita. Nanti ada kalau dari Devsos kalau mau ikut menjawab silakan ya. Kita sudah apa namanya orang yang bertanggung jawab untuk survei yang lalu dan mungkin bisa menjawab. Ya silakan Ibu.
Hi, my name is Mirna from Sumeru. Previously, I work in Faculty of Psychology, and we have a collaborative program with IOM, the National Organization of Migration. Where we provide psychosocial support for migrants, specifically women and children. In the field, I observe that the children's rights is mainly violated. They couldn't go to school because the state school doesn't allow them to go there, and then they don't have like proper playground. Always beaten by their parents because that is part of their culture. And then the worst is they been locked up in a detention center, and they just could go out for like 2 days and 1 week. So what I want to ask is, UNICEF has an initiative or recommendation or suggestion to child protection in this context, because as you know, Indonesia is a place where we have many many asylum seekers, refugees transit here. Thank you.
Thank you. Satu lagi, silakan Cipta yang lihat ya, yang paling ganteng atau paling jelek? Oh, yang paling jelek nanti.
Terima kasih Pak Irwanto karena saya berangkat jam 5 pagi dari kota saya. Terima kasih. Saya ingin satu bagian berbagi informasi kepada Ibu Marta. Saya banyak terima kasih Ibu Marta saya bisa ketemu karena saya banyak baca tulisan Anda dan saya pakai untuk presentasi di beberapa kota di Indonesia. Terima kasih sebelumnya. Karena saya merasa bahagia bisa ketemu Anda. Yang pertama, saya memandang bahwa perlindungan anak Indonesia di persimpangan jalan. Ada banyak kemajuan yang dicapai oleh pemerintah Indonesia, oleh bangsa ini. Ada juga banyak ketertinggalan. Misalnya banyak kemajuan kita meratifikasi banyak konvensi internasional yang berkaitan dengan HAM, yang di dalamnya juga ada unsur pemenuhan hak dan perlindungan. Ada banyak ketertinggalan karena ada tabrakan antara undang-undang. Misalnya ketika kita mengesahkan Undang-Undang Nomor 11 Tahun 2012 tentang Sistem Peradilan Pidana Anak, kita gembira sekali ada pendekatan keadilan restoratif dan integrasi. Tapi tahun lalu ketika kita merubah Undang-Undang 35 Nomor 2014 perubahan atas Undang-Undang 2022 tentang Perlindungan Anak, kita terjebak karena Undang-Undang mengikuti Pasal 82 menafikan Undang-Undang Perlindungan Undang-Undang SPA. Itu tetap anak sulit diketahui ketika ancaman pidana penjara lebih dari 7 tahun. Itu artinya ada kemajuan tapi ada ketertinggalan. Tapi saya optimis. Kalau saya lihat di jelas dari tahun 1995 sangat buruk ya situasi perlindungan anak di Indonesia. Perlahan-perlahan tapi pasti ada banyak perubahan. Perubahan disebabkan oleh banyak advokasi yang dilakukan oleh baik oleh Indonesia, oleh Plan, oleh SIF, oleh Ahmad Jaya, karena kami belajar dari Ahmad Jaya sejak 95, misalnya dengan Pak Dewanto. Kemudian ada banyak sekali lembaga yang Save the Children misalnya, yang juga melakukan advokasi dan ada perubahan dan ada niatan baik dari pemerintah Indonesia untuk melakukan banyak perubahan. Semenjak 2009 nanti perkenalkan advokasi sistem building approach, telah banyak perubahan di berbagai kota di Indonesia ketika membuat perda di mana seperti di Klaten, Solo, Provinsi Jawa Tengah, Provinsi Jawa Timur, Provinsi Sulawesi Selatan, mereka membuat perda di mana yang berbasis sistem. Itu dari sudut regulasi. Dan bagaimana dengan implementasi, mereka sudah membangun satu sistem yang mengutamakan pencegahan dibanding dengan respon. Kemudian ada juga kemajuan di KLA. Di kota pelayanan anak, saya melihat ada banyak kemajuan dalam indikator kesehatan di situ sangat jelas. Yang disebut kota layanan, kalau indikator kesehatannya tercapai, misalnya ABCD, indikator pendidikan juga sangat jelas. Disebut kota yang layak anak, layak bagi anak kalau indikator pendidikan bisa dicapai. Dan indikator perlindungan anak, perlindungan khusus juga sangat jelas. Dan sekarang ini Kementerian Pemberdayaan dan Perlindungan Anak sedang melakukan perubahan indikator agar lebih clear lagi setelah mendapat masukan dari berbagai daerah dan juga lebih tajam ke menuju pada CRC, walaupun utuh ke CRC sangat sulit karena ini indikator kotanya yang disebut layak bagi anak. Yang perlu dimiliki Indonesia adalah indikator implementasi CRC. Yang ini belum ada dan kami berharap pemerintah akan melakukan perubahan itu. Ada satu menit pengalaman kami dengan dua kabupaten Cianjur dan kabupaten Bandung Barat. Kami bekerja bersama kepala dinas dan kepala bidang, camat, lurah, tokoh masyarakat, tokoh agama, orang tua, membuat pengembangan masyarakat untuk perlindungan anak. Dan ketika ini diajak terus bersama-sama di dalam merumuskan sesuatu di tingkat desa yang melibatkan Pemda, Pemda sekarang mulai tertarik dengan itu, misalnya mereka mewajibkan kepala dinas pendidikan atau utusannya datang ke desa tentang kondisi pendidikan anak. Bukan hanya enrollment, bukan hanya ketika dia mendaftar, tapi juga tingkat partisipasi anak, kehadiran, dan apakah ada kekerasan di sekolah. Kemudian di kesehatan juga, ada rapat rutin sekarang di dua kabupaten itu, Cianjur dan Kabupaten Bandung Barat. Ini sudah pengalaman bahwa kami ingin menunjukkan bahwa saya membenarkan ada Pemda yang pasif, tetapi ketika kita ajak mereka membangun bersama, ternyata Pemda bisa aktif. Ya, itu saja pengalaman dari apa yang ada di Indonesia. Kesimpulannya, Indonesia bersemangat dalam tentang perlindungan anak, tetapi kami tetap optimis dibanding tahun 95 ketika saya mengekor ke Pak Iwanto. Terima kasih.
Thank you so much. Well, first, it seemed with the help of my friend Ali, who is translating, that there were more contributions to our reflections than really questions. And so I'm very thankful for your very important reflections on how Indonesia is evolving to becoming a really child-friendly nation, where all children can grow up without violence. One topic that was emphasized, and of course I very much agree with it, is that we certainly need to, whatever is done at the national level, is important because it sends the message and frames the action at all levels of the country. You know, the country is very diverse, it's a big archipelago, you have mentioned different languages, of course there are different traditions, the perceptions may be different, the actors will make a difference at the local level may be different. So the real implementation will happen at the community level, at the village level, at the district level. And the contribution of all the actors, it may be the local leader, it may be the religious leader and the religious community. It may be those who work in the village. It may be sometimes there may be a village committee where some of the respected members of the village have an influence in decisions. All of those should be part of the reflections on how to do the best decisions that have a positive impact on the life of children, including by preventing and addressing any situation of violence. And as our friend from Plan was referring to, of course, it's fantastic that we create a trust amongst families to feel that they can disclose situations of violence. It takes a lot of effort, psychological, emotional, and very often it creates tension in the family because there are always the members in the family who prefer to remain silent and not to disclose the issues. But we need to meet the expectations of families with follow-up action that can really then follow the case, investigate what has happened, who is responsible, how the victim can be supported and can be recovering and have a second chance for reintegrating into society, going back to school, feeling respected and looking after the future with hope. And all of that implies that everyone will assume some responsibilities. It may be the police. And I have seen in many countries the difference it makes when we have a children's or children and women's desk with specialized members of the police ready to listen to the stories, investigate the case, support the family and the child. And in brackets, I will tell you, one message that to me has been very important by children is, if you want to help the child, never forget the family, because the child does not live in isolation. And if you only try to support the child, forgetting the role the mother and the father will play, or all the siblings, we will fail in our attempt. So it's a very important message that I think is also relevant. So it's true that implementation is fundamental. The local level, community level is essential. And there is no way we can be effective if the resources are not made available. I understand that in Indonesia, the Home Affairs Ministry will have a very important role to play in this regard. And for that reason, in our discussions with government during this week, we are also emphasizing and encouraging the Home Affairs Ministry to take an active role and be part of this big alliance, this big movement in favor of children that we want to build with all these different actors at the community, at provincial and central level. So a lot to do in that regard. Another friend said, budget is important, but if we don't participate in the planning, we don't have the sense of ownership. We don't feel that this relates to me. I don't see my problems reflected in the decisions, and that is, of course, an obstacle. And I think it works for adults, for parents, for families, but it also works for children. And you know, some of the friends who have made comments referred to the initiative on child-friendly cities, you know, which exist in Indonesia and exist in many parts of the world. I think probably the most important secret of success in child-friendly cities is when we give children an opportunity to contribute their views, their suggestions, their recommendations to the planning, to the decisions, to the budget of the city. One thing that really makes a difference is if the city gives feedback to the children, both about what has been done in relation to the suggestions that the child has put forward, the children, or why it was not possible or reasonable or adequate to follow up to the expectation of the children. Because sometimes we cannot do it, but at least the children need to understand why not, and what was the alternative, and why that alternative was a better solution. The same for adults. We need, but this is what democracy is about, isn't it? I mean, we invest in contributing to good solutions, but we want to understand why the solutions are different from my expectations, or how at least it can contribute to solving the problems I have identified. So, of course, participatory processes are absolutely fundamental, and that's what makes child protection systems strong, in fact. That's a big part of the decision. The final thing I I wanted to address from our latest friend. One of the big challenges in being doing good things for children is articulating, coordinating the different actions of different actors. You know, the finance ministry or budget ministry will always think they are more important, and they have a very important factor in hand when they decide or propose the way the budget is going to be allocated. The education ministry feels they are because they can shape the minds and lives of children, and they are trusted by families very often. So that is important. But in fact, there is no single ministry, and I'm sure you will agree with me, even a very strong ministry for children, even if that would be the case in all countries, it's not enough to achieve the solutions we want. So articulation of everyone at the national, subnational, and local level is fundamental. And there is a need to periodically sit together, discuss together, review what was achieved, why not, other things were done, what can be done in the future, what is most urgent, are there new concerns we didn't consider before? And without that interactive process, we will not go anywhere. And that's what the Convention on the Rights of the Child dream is about. You know, it's about translating the beautiful principles and articles in the convention into things that make a difference for people. Every day, when I go to school, when I am a mother at home, when I'm working in my law office or in my university. And that is the real beauty of the Convention on the Rights of the Child. And I will tell you, in my view, there is no other better treaty than that one, because it really captures all the dreams of all of us, even if we have different religions and speak different languages and come from different countries. But it has to still what unites us around children. And that is a uniquely, you know, strong and absolutely irresistible agenda, you know, for all of us. I don't know if I've forgotten anything. Oh, the final point is the data, the question of the data. Data is, I think data is very important. You know, one of the things we used to say is that when a child is not counted by the data in a country, the child is not counted. And this is reality, you know. If we forget children with disabilities in our attempts to gather data in a country, we will certainly not plan services, interventions and support for children with disabilities. We ignore them. If a child doesn't have a birth certificate, the child does not exist in the planning, in the decisions, in the budget. So the data is the instrument that will allow for every child to be reflected. And for us to understand that we are not talking about abstract children, we are talking about human stories, human hopes, frustrations, and we have an empathy to all of them. So data is fundamental. And for governments, it's fundamental because governments with data will decide in the best way possible. Otherwise, they will guess, and sometimes very wrong if they guess, because they don't have that evidence to support their decision. So, I think for Indonesia, if Indonesia would be able to collect together all the data that exists on all forms of violence in Indonesia, and could agree that there are areas that have been forgotten. A friend spoke about migrant families, migrant children. It's very often an ignored area. We pretend that they are part of us, but they don't get the attention that they need. If we miss data on children who are affected by migration, they are locked up or they do not go to school and so on, then we can invest in getting that data systematically and make good use of it. So data is fundamental, and I see Indonesia as giving a big lesson to many countries in the region by having a strong system, and I see the universities playing a fundamental role. So I think you will be playing that role.
Thank you. I would like to highlight two things. One is, of course, availability of data, and we have actually a good resource person here who can contribute to that. But secondly is on IOM and on children living in detention.
the case seems to be like this. I mean, the flow of refugees from Middle East and other countries, especially minority groups, religion, because to Indonesia is huge, because country of choice, country of destination, refused to have. Yeah, we know which country they are. So Indonesia is actually caught in between. And the problem here is, do we finally decide to open all the fences so that all these detainees or children work together with the community? Is the community ready to accept them as? And it seems like there's a debate on that. So I think what I mean, I may be wrong, but my listening to resources seems to go to that direction, that Indonesia is going to take the integration policy, but they need to get the social worker ready. Again, everything falls on the shoulder of social workers. Sometimes I just have the feeling that the social workers here in Indonesia do not actually have the full awareness of the humongous challenges that they have to confront with, because many of the problems need their professional contribution. But up to now, there are still some weaknesses in the profession, and also in the law for the profession. On the other group,
terima kasih Mbak, terima kasih Bu Marta, memiliki kesempatan untuk menyampaikan data hasil survei di survei kekerasan terhadap anak. Kemensos melaksanakan survei ini, survei kekerasan terhadap anak ini tahun 2013 atas bantuan UNICEF dengan Kemenas, KPPA, Kemensos, BPS, sehingga perhitungannya kita menggunakan BPS dan ini hasil respon ke bapak rendah, tetapi kita menggunakan kita sudah ada standar RSM, RSI sudah bisa memenuhi syarat. Kalau kita menemukan bahwa any violence dari anak-anak yang setidaknya mendapatkan perlakuan tidak setidaknya satu tindak kekerasan seksual, fisik, emosional adalah satu dari dua anak laki-laki sebelum umur 18 tahun, ini pada responden 18-24 tahun, dan satu dari enam perempuan itu terjadi pada saat mereka sepanjang masa kanak-kanak. Kemudian pada anak-anak yang kita ada dua responden, ada pada anak-anak yang 13 tahun sampai 17 tahun, ditemukan bahwa satu dari tiga laki-laki itu mengalami setidaknya salah satu kekerasan fisik, emosional, seksual, dan satu dari lima perempuan mengalami kekerasan setidaknya salah satu tindak kekerasan seksual fisik emosional dalam 12 bulan terakhir. Itu datanya. Kemudian memang pelaku lebih banyak adalah teman, terutama laki-laki, teman. Itu yang mungkin bisa disampaikan untuk yang lainnya mungkin perlu sendiri. Terima kasih.
Demikian. Demikian data yang ada saat ini memang masih disikapi dengan sangat kritis, terutama karena persoalan metodologi. Tapi kalau ingin dicari peluang untuk memanfaatkan ini sebetulnya ada. I would like also to hear your response. I mean, to see the parliaments of EU having a special assembly or a special session on children is something that we actually need, and it's hard to go into that political process. Basically, maybe a lot of us here who are activists need to talk more to the political party rather than complain. I mean, what do you know about that? EU Parliament. Thank you.
First of all, one idea that I think has worked well in some countries that I wanted to mention because perhaps it could work in Indonesia is that national parliaments have created a national child rights caucus or commission that brings members of parliament from all parties, all political parties, but also representing different commissions in parliament, you know, the budget and the legal affairs and social affairs and justice, whatever, all of them, and meet regularly to see what are the critical areas that require the attention of the parliament, either because there is legislation that needs to be enacted or reviewed or improved, or because there is a loophole that needs to be filled, or a policy that could be promoted, or the budget, when approved by Parliament, could be addressing with greater emphasis protection of children or services for children. And I think having a caucus of that nature in Indonesia could really elevate the debate and promote periodic discussions that could in some cases be open to the public and help to promote waves of interest and discussion that will, you know, reach out to everybody in the nation. This has been very helpful in many other countries, and it's an idea that I wanted to share with you. In the European Union Parliament, a similar idea was promoted a number of years ago. To be honest, there is a very big lobby for women's rights in the European Union Parliament. That is no one questions, you know, when there is any question about women's rights, everybody is deciding to come and discuss and contribute. But if we say children, you know, when we will have time, we will go to that, you know, but it's not yet a priority. So, with the European Union Parliament, we all attempted to identify who could be the champions, parliamentarians, who could bring children's issues into the forefront. And in fact, sometimes it was political parties that could not be so favorable of human rights, but also some got interested in children's rights, which was very good. And now there is a front, there is a group that systematically meets, that engages with civil society, that adopts positions, policy positions on critical topics, and therefore that has an impact, of course. But again, one thing is to do it at the regional level, the other thing is to do it at the national level, where the decisions can have a real impact on the life of children. And I think we can start in Indonesia with the national one, right? And if, and in those, you know, in my view, it would be very good to invite children once and, you know, once in a while to those debates, you know, engage with young people. What is your view? How do you assess the role of parliamentarians in the country? And how well they do things for children? What is the impact it is having? It could be so energizing for everyone. So I would agree with that.
We do have young parliamentarians, actually. Okay, we still have time, am I right? Okay, we still have time. A lot of time, please. Ibu silakan. Oh, semua silakan. Semakin ada, jangan terlupa. Semakin ada dua.
My name is Papa from Sociology and Development. In some places, I see the phenomena where the use of violence is allowed to handle harmful face with love. For example, when the children are interrogated by the police, police use physical violence like slapping or verbal violence. This example is based on the victim's confession. I want to ask, what is the right approach to handle children who face the law without using violence? So they both want to answer honestly when interrogated by the police Emma, begin. Thank you.
My name is Yu Brong Kim. I'm from UNDP, from Project Medical Fever 1, and my question is obviously focusing on the legal response to violence against children. We all know the shortcoming of repression and the limits of the exemplary nature of sanctions against perpetrators. My question is whether we might, what has been the international response to the idea of naming and shaming? In other words, to publicize the name of perpetrators and see whether that might serve as a useful deterrent for possible future violence and future crime of this sort. Obviously, in Indonesia, we would have some difficulty with that because of the problem of the finality of judgment, but which is very much challenged by the legal system. But the international response would be of interest, whether the name and shame is indeed something that could be explored. Thank you.
My name is Valentina from World Fishhead. I'd like to ask about how can we give more centers to speed up to detection? Because we can see that violence happens everywhere, including in schools, in health facilities, and other public services. But somehow we can hardly see, like, for example, schools that have child protection mechanism. We can see many efforts being done in Indonesia. Also from our organization, like Commission, we have some models, education models where child protection is integrated. Somehow there are many schools that don't have this child protection mechanism in their school. Also about mindset of people serving children. So from your experience, like if you have any studies, how can we speed up sectors so they can have more attention and they can help together to act to take action
on violence against children. Ya, kami dari Jakarta Utara, jadi gini, anak kreatif itu sama pengurusnya dibikin KPP dan kelurahan. Ini anak dari daerah ya, dibikin KPP dengan kelurahan gitu. Akhirnya mereka dibikin KPP, kita tuh anak-anak itu benar-benar anak gitu. Jadi akhirnya kita bukan hanya pengen musuhin mereka, cuma kita pengen maksudnya ke sekolah. Jadi kita berikan program untuk sekolah. Dan sekarang ini program sekolahnya gak ada gitu. Jadi pengennya bagaimana kita membuat program sekolah untuk mereka. Selain dari itu juga, kita juga ada anak-anak program juga. Gimana untuk membuat KTP kekurangan itu bagaimana, bagaimana juga untuk sekolahnya juga, bagaimana yang kekuasaan juga.
Thank you. My name is Peter, and I'm from District Refugee Service Indonesia. Against about refugee and asylum seekers. I have some questions and also comments for previous questions that mentioned before, and you also mentioned about refugee children in Africa camp. My question are relating to children in Indonesia, although not children of Indonesia, because the children of asylum seeker and refugees also in Indonesia. I propose to ask about hundreds of children inside Indonesia again, immigration detention center, and they are being detained because of their status as asylum seeker or refugee. Some of them are unaccompanied minor. It's not about the detainee that adult, but it's about children. The first one is, what would be UNICEF stance regarding their condition? And the second one, detention center could expose the children with a risk of ill treatment and limited rights of free movement. What would be the best approach to overcome the challenge? Especially, what can we engage to government? Because sometimes we think that Indonesian government thinks the problem of children and refugee and asylum seeker is not their responsibility. So how can we engage the government to end this problem? Especially, this is the comment that we have experience in our project in Bogor, in Cisarua, Cipayung, and the area in West Java. The refugee and asylum seeker can deal with the local community, and they can put informal education for their children, so they can survive, especially for informal education and also informal job, like making bread, they call it naan, something like that. So how can we approach to government to solve the problem about the children of refugee and asylum seeker, especially in Indonesia? Thank you.
My name is Wuling, I'm from the Spanish Research Institute. I think we have mentioned about data. The data is not enough, the data is difficult to acquire. Smero recently has produced poverty map and livelihood in Indonesia. And with the support of Smero, the UNICEF, we were able to produce a poverty map with child issues indicated. I'm very happy to hear that we have enough data from government sources and from other sources, from me, for example. And I would like to invite all of you to share with him your data so that we can put it in our poverty map to enrich the existing poverty map. Our poverty map is available if you visit our website. It's open and it's free of charge. So you can use for whatever program that you might need when you require data. Better targeting is very important. Ibu, I'll come to your office. And also Maria, and also many others of you, all who have data. Let's put them together. Let's pull them. And we can do much better in preventing violence against children, or even to lift them, to a certain level of
children, happy children that you would like to see. Thank you. And Ibu Manta, you have been very important. Thank you. I was trying to see if you would forget that I would have to revert to you. thank you so much. Very good points have been put forward, and I think this suggestion was again so important. Sometimes we think we don't know, and there are so many sources that we can capitalize upon and then be much better informed and do better things for children. Let me address a few, at least some of the things. A number of colleagues have been bringing back the question of asylum seekers, refugees, migrant children, and referring to these children being deprived of liberty, being in detention centers. Now, our position is that the violation of liberty is, as the convention stresses, as you know, only a measure of exceptional use in cases where all other possible solutions have not been possible, have not worked out. And very often we, everyone in a way, feels tempted to go to the easy solution. We put children in a detention center, and sometimes we even say, because like that, the child will be better protected. You know, the child will be with some family members, the child will have some food, not necessarily education, but we will talk about it later, no? And we forget to test if there are other options. And so we consider that no child should be deprived of liberty solely on the basis of the migration status of that child or because the child is seeking asylum in a country. We need to find alternatives to the child, for that child. The second thing is that, as our colleague who spoke last was implying, that one important message of the Convention on the Rights of the Child is that any state, like Indonesia, is responsible for all children who happen to be under the jurisdiction of the state, either because they are nationals, or they are foreigners in the country, or they are migrating into the country, or they are seeking asylum in the country. The state is responsible to ensure that this child has all the opportunities to develop to his or her full potential. So that is important, because we should not categorize children. Above all, they are children, you know. Afterwards, we see if they are seeking asylum or migrant, or if they come from Java, or if they come from West Timor, you know. That's the second thing. That should not be an obstacle to protect the child. So that's the first thing I wanted to stress. The second thing is, it is true, in many countries, law enforcement agents and policemen use force to arrest the child, and then in a very violent manner places the child in a detention center. Now, this is forbidden. It's not acceptable. And we have produced two studies about this issue. I would invite you to look into our website, because perhaps the studies will support you. But more importantly, I wanted to mention that in United Nations, over the last year, we have developed a new set of standards, which have a very long name, but I'm going to say it slowly. It's called Model Strategies and Practical Measures for the Prevention of Violence Against Children in the Criminal Justice System. And that important document explains not only what the Convention says, but how the countries can implement the provisions of the Convention. And I'm sure that will leave a lot of good ideas for all of you. But there is one message that is very important, and that is that no child should be subject to any form of violence, either when the child is arrested, when the child is brought to a police station, when the child is serving a sentence in a prison, or in whatever context. Violence is not an answer. And the state has the responsibility to oversee that child, to safeguard that child, and in fact to punish those who may use violence. So we cannot be passive or tolerant in relation to the use of violence, and this is the most important thing to retain. The third thing I wanted to mention, we need to introduce in prisons, in schools, in care institutions, always mechanisms for child protection. What should they do? They should be there to provide advice and counseling to children. They should be there to guide the child if the child needs help. But if there is any form of violence being used against the child, that mechanism needs to intervene to help investigate, to identify those who are responsible, to promote the punishment of those responsible, and to make known that there was a response, so that we don't believe that it's okay to deal with children in this way. So I schools play such an important role, and it's very important that these mechanisms are established in all schools, and I'm sure you can help us with that in the best way possible. That brings me to the question raised by our friend from UNDP. And this is a very, it's a difficult question again. You know, is it okay to name and shame countries as a way of keeping pressure on governments not to use the bad responses in relation to children, including the use of violence against children or being harsh on children? I see name and shame as a final answer, to be honest, my own view. I think we need to try other solutions before getting there. Why do I say that? I don't deny that in some circumstances this is important, because it's a way of showing that we need to fight impunity. And impunity cannot prevail in a country, because it gives a bad message that we accept violence or we accept violations of human rights as a way to deal with citizens or foreigners who are in the jurisdiction of the state. But we need to prevent from the start. We need to investigate. We need to identify who is responsible for wrongdoing. We need to make the sentences known so that people feel that they can trust the justice system, that the system is responding to the expectations of the country. And by simply naming and shaming, we don't get there. So there is a long way to go, and we need to empower young people to feel that there are means they can read, that they can use. And there is one means that I want to bring to your attention. There is now a third protocol to the Convention on the Rights of the Child. You may have studied it, and this third protocol establishes a system of complaints before the Committee on the Rights of the Child in Geneva for any situation where the child is a victim of a violation of his or her rights and the state has not addressed the right, has not adopted the right measure to respond to that violation. And by bringing the case to an international court, in fact, we can bring pressure on the government. Implicitly, we are naming and shaming, but that's not what comes as the first idea to the mind of people. And we are helping the child feeling that not only the case is listened to, but there is a solution being brought to the child. Indonesia has not yet ratified this protocol. I know that many of you are lobbying the government to move fast in this, to this end. And I hope it will happen soon. We have now 15 countries who have ratified. And one that comes to my mind is Thailand, very not far away from Indonesia, which was one of the first to ratify. So there is a possibility to do this, and perhaps we can mobilize our efforts to reach that. Our friend here was speaking about children who are victims of trafficking. If I understood well the translation, these children may not have an identity card, and as a result, will be, in some cases, not allowed to go to school. This is not correct. This is against the Convention on the Rights of the Child. Even a victim of trafficking is entitled to the right to education. How that right is going to be assured may require many different interventions. Imagine that the child is trafficked, does not speak Bahasa Indonesia, and we need to find a way of creating an environment where the teaching to that child may be done in his or her own language. You may need a special teacher or translation of the documents, of the books, of the materials. But that should not be an excuse not to provide the identity card and not to provide the access to school and the progression in schooling to that child. So I hope we can support you in doing that here in Indonesia. I think I have addressed all the questions, but if I've forgotten anything, please forgive me. I'm trying to keep my notes, this will have much more to be said, of course. The questions are too complex to be addressed in a few minutes, and I apologize if sometimes I give a very simplistic answer, but it is in view of the time we have. But I want to say that you are so well informed and so committed, and by being here today, you have such a great opportunity to unite efforts. The same way we heard the recommendation, pull the data together and let us bring it together to have a bigger picture of what children are in Indonesia. I think together you are such a resistible force for change, and you can bring great ideas to the government, you can monitor how well things are being done, and you can give suggestions that make a difference in the life of children. So my encouragement to you is that continue to talk to each other and to share your experiences and good practices, including through websites and through social networks and through Facebook and whatever the answer may be, because you will be helping children in Indonesia, and that is priceless. And I would like to continue to hear from all of you. So thank you again.
Big round of applause, please. Not only that the lecture has been so inspiring, but she brought us examples and also some experiences that may confirm or confirm our own experiences. But yet, as we know, she also brought up a lot of challenges to you, me, myself, as actors in this country. And for that, thank you so much. Applause again, please. I know that you may have more questions, but please visit the UN website. If you type her name, you will get into several languages there. Dr. Pais has also been the past president or past director of Innocenti Center, right? Innocenti Center is UNICEF Center for Research. And if you go, you will find a wonderful publication, very good publication. I encourage you to do that. Yeah. And of course, then the UN, itself has a powerful source of knowledge, especially on the legal aspect of child violence. Terima kasih. Semuanya Bapak Ibu sekalian sudah hadir pada sore ini. Sebagian bertahan sampai sore, saya kira itu luar biasa. Dan lagi-lagi bagi yang ingin langsung menjalin hubungan dengan apa Ibu Martha Pais, please do so. Ibu Martha kan punya beberapa menit di sini, mungkin bisa apa mencatat email atau alamat atau yang mungkin akan berguna bagi Anda nanti jika Anda bekerja. Dan misalnya, child participation, Ibu Martha merupakan salah satu penulis tentang child participation. Sedangkan child participation di Indonesia itu masih susah banget ya. Tapi Ibu Martha sudah menulis, sudah mendiskusikannya, saya kira itu something yang bukan learn from her. I'm not only glad, but I'm thankful so much to be able to assist you and
chair
this session. Thank you so much.
Terima kasih. Mungkin progress atau lagi kami punya sedikit penghargaan kepada Ibu Martha dan Ibu Malta untuk penyerahan kalian today. Terima kasih kepada Bapak Ibu sekalian, teman-teman, rekan-rekan yang sudah hadir pada hari ini. Sekali lagi terima kasih banyak atas partisipasinya. Semoga kita bertemu lagi pada kesempatan. Selamat sore, assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
jangan lupa UI membuka program konsentrasi kriminologi untuk child protection, untuk master. Jadi kalau ada ini membuka